Invite Kim to ask question. Kim, you can unmute and ask your question. Yeah, please go ahead.
Hello. Why can't we take complete history through phone and review the patient's reports and everything through WhatsApp so that we can minimize the contact with the patient? So whatever required physical examination can be completed and history will take through phone. Why can't we do like that?
Yeah, definitely, Dr. Sir, that is one of the very good suggestion. Actually, we are planning to do one more follow-up session in the next week, first part of the next week, wherein we are trying to see that how this digital technology, whether they be apps or web-based or WhatsApp or Google Duo or whatever, how can we use it to complement to our practice, wherein our type of clinical care that we are giving is not compromised. So we will be coming forth with this concept, and we'll be taking your inputs also to how better to use these digital platforms and what are the different platforms, and we will try to assess them and go slightly into the depth. Me and Chalpati are planning to do it in the first week of the next week, first half of the next week. Thank you.
I know.
How about making now the emergency cases we'll allow? All the non-emergency cases who come for follow-up, how about keeping some IT personnel who will put all their old record, important record, into digitalize them? We should make the for the follow-up cases at least paperless.
Yes.
Number one. This was my first question. The second question is, how about you know, the patients who come, they should not be allowed to carry fomites with them, and they carry bags, so many records, x-rays, all those things. They should be allowed to keep them at the entrance, and their hands should be sanitized. This sanitizer, you know, the security person, I have seen the supermarkets are there, they spray on the hands, they just rub it as if it's a scent, something like a scent or something. They're not rubbing it. So most of the people do not know how to use the sanitizer. Sanitizer has to be rubbed nicely into the creases and the nail bed and everywhere. That's not being followed. They're thinking that when that chemical is sprayed on your hands, it's enough. Everything is killed. No, it's not like that. So one thing is this. So how about, is there any substitute which can usually be more stronger? Can we ask them to dip their hands like that, you know? In old days, when I used to study in Usmania, we used to have two bowls, you know, with a towel. You know, one used to have Dettol water, another is to clean water. We used to dip our hands in Dettol water, take out our hands, and then dip it into the other hand. Such things can be kept and frequently changed so that the people rub their hands in that and come. What is the efficacy of this thing compared to this not properly used sanitizer? Thank you. Will you give me a clear picture about this? I'll be happy.
Yeah, sir. Regarding the first part of the question, so if practically, I want to say we also run an healthcare IT company and we have our application. What I practically am planning to do at this point of time is we have a citizen's application wherein they can upload the reports, which I will be able to see it digitally. Or if we don't have the application, the simple thing is, before the patients come to the hospital, we should encourage them that they should call to the hospital and take a prior appointment. Once prior appointment is taken, the second aspect that our staff should give to the patient and their attendants are, please upload all your old relevant records, whether it be previous prescriptions or previous reports, including the medicines. The pictures of the medicines has to be taken a picture and sent on a WhatsApp, so that our staff will forward it to us. So whenever the patient comes, we go, we open our maybe our laptop or our tablet and see into the reports of the patients, rather than touching all the reports which they are carrying, which may have the chances of fomites. The second aspect, sir, as you suggested, one thing that is present in the Disney World is also that there have a large maybe wash machine like things are there in which both hands can be dipped and alcohol based diluted solutions are present in which the kids will keep their hands there, wash it and bring it out. As you suggested in the previous era, there used to be two balls used to be there. One was with the Dettol or the Savlon, and that was a clean thing. But yeah, sir, this can be used. But if we are seeing more number of patients, right? We need to balance depending upon our comfortability by keeping our hands and washing it repeatedly within such type of a disinfecting solution is better, or using some gloves as suggested by Chalpati, which can be thrown, taken out and thrown after each and every patient is there. Depends upon one's own preferences. We can stick on to any of the things. Chalpati, you want to add anything?
Yeah, that's okay. Yeah, fine. I think practicing inner and outer gloves is also important, but even we have to sanitize those inner gloves also each time, because you will be handling your pens and papers when you are wearing your inner gloves. Once you start writing the prescription and all, you will remove the outer gloves and start using them. Still, we have to sanitize. So, as of now, as you told, I think alcohol-based sanitizers are better.
Yeah, okay. Dr. Srinagesh, you want to ask any question?
Yeah, I've got one query about, am I audible now?
Yes,
Magesh. Yeah, I've got one query about the medico-legal implications of patients not sticking to the safe distancing guidelines. If somebody doesn't do it, are we well within our rights to refuse to see the patient if it
yes.
doesn't comply with the clinic?
Yes, I think as I told you in my first presentation, we created an informed consent and patient checklist wherein actually patient has to sign, and there is a compliance form also that they'll be adhering to the social distancing guidelines and all. So in fact, one of my colleagues actually refused to see the patient. In fact, we should all do that if patient is not ready to sign it up, or if
that's
they don't.
That's a big problem nowadays.
Yeah. True. That's true. You have every right to reject the patient.
Yeah.
Ideally, separating patients rather than in space, I think it is more better to separate them by time. Say, if my time of consultation with each and every patient is, say, by around 10 minutes, it's better by I separate giving one appointment to the second appointment by 20 or 25 minutes or 30 minutes, so that the crowding within the waiting area will be bare.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, Dr. Kali, some YouTube viewers. He's asking that some of the clinics are very small, where there's no scope of having a separate OP for general and COVID suspected patients. What to do in such situation?
Separating by time.
Okay.
Separating by time and going to digital platform for follow-up cases.
Okay. Arjun from YouTube is asking, any problem with usage of AC? What kind of AC? Centralized AC, window AC, what kind of AC is suitable?
Air conditioning.
Sorry, I didn't.
Air conditioning.
Air conditioning in OPD or hospital or clinics? Is it advisable or what? Or what kind of air conditioning is better? Centralized AC or window AC?
Do you want to take?
I think there are some concerns about, sucking up air and all. But it is always better to have, if you are following the other strict protocols to screen the COVID patients or from non-COVID patients to separate them and all, you can as well use your regular air conditioners, because it may be difficult to change everything, including the air conditioners. Some of the hospitals may be having central air conditioners, so it may be difficult. So all of a sudden, if you ask the hospital to change to a negative suction area, negative suction room, it may be difficult. So if you follow the protocols of checklist, triaging and all, probably you are separating majority of or all of the patients from your OPD
so that you are not at risk. But if you have an option to do that in your clinic, probably you can shift on to a negative suction area.
Okay. Quite a few attendees are telling the extensive information you people have given, but they're feeling it is difficult to implement. What are your comments?
So it's just a thought process which we have to implement. So depending, the practicing places will vary depending upon a small clinics with a single room to a larger corporate hospital or a larger institutes. So depending upon, see, one thing is clear that we are amidst of a storm of a COVID-19 pandemic, right? We have to get prepared for ourselves. So as much as possible, implementation here is not a choice, but it is mandatory. One thing Dr. Mohan Patro has asked that doctors above 65 years have to attend the hospital at least twice in a week, rarely comes in contact with non-COVID patients. What precautions we should take with our family members? Sir, good evening. One thing is, as I discussed, it's always better rather than working twice a week or thrice a week, it's better to divide into 15-day slot. The reason being that if one half of the team get quarantined, the other half can take care of the clinical work so that the hospital and the department can keep running. Second thing is, without extensive testing, all our potential contacts, the patients who are for us for follow-up or each and every, including our staff members, are potential coronavirus infection patients. So we can't say that these people are corona positive and these people are not correct. Corona positive. In spite of having down the line, we may be getting very clearly the antibody testing thing, but still for the antibody to come positive, it will take at least 4 days to 1 week of time. So with sure, we can't say that this patient is a corona positive or a corona not positive. Our attitude and mindset should be with each and every interaction that we are happening, our interaction is happening, we have to consider them as a corona positive patient and has to take our due precautions. What things we have to do with our family members? First thing is, sir, as I suggested, once coming to home, we have to remove our clothes, we have to keep our shoes outside, take a shower, and only then come out and meet with the family. It's always better to maintain the physical distance with the family members, particularly with the elders if they are at home. A third thing is, whenever if at least the smallest tinge of any symptoms are there, we should not be overconfident that it is a simple sore throat or a simple headache because of sleeplessness, etc., etc. So we should be getting ourselves tested for that one. And what extra precautions we should take? Social distancing is one thing. Second thing is, sir, our plates and drinking glasses should be different should be labeled and should be different when compared, and we should be using our own utensils of eating and drinking water. And if there are multiple bathrooms are there, it's always better that the people who go to the hospital, they use a separate bathroom when compared to the other family members.
Okay.
Yeah, how far it is practicable in our setup?
Sir, this was only an overview by keeping in mind right from a smaller clinic to a bigger hospital. So one thing we should be very clear that we have to be much, much extra cautious than what we used to practice. Our practice is going to be completely different for at least next 6 months. And depending upon our setup, whether a small clinic or this thing, what are all the things that we need to implement so that we can reduce the infection? Say in a bigger corporate hospital, they can keep in a sensor based hand wash right at the entrance. But in a small clinic, we can keep a simple wash basin and train one of the staff members that whenever a patient comes, we need to ask them to wash their hands thoroughly, and showing them exactly how to wash their hands and then send it. So depending upon our setups, we need to innovate, or we need to change them accordingly. This is not that everything fits for each and every clinic. Depending upon that one, we should take care that all the patients who enter us are entering after a thorough washing of the hands with the soap or by using a proper sanitizer and washing their hands. We should be advising them to come in only with the mask, with limited number of attendants, as Shilpati was saying, and we should emphasize that they should not touch anything. We should make our protocol so that the patients doesn't wait for a longer period of time. The minimal contact or a no-touch policy should be there as much as possible from the clinician's point of view. Maximum report should be seen on a digital platform through WhatsApp or a web-based thing. And when examination has to be done, a due precaution should be done as if the patient is a corona positive patient, and then proceed. So these are the few basics that we need to keep in mind, and depending upon the size of the room in which we are practicing, the type of the clinic or the practice things, we need to we need to innovate ourselves and see that at each and every step, right from the patient coming to the clinic and leaving the clinic, or coming to the hospital and leaving the hospital, whether OPD or an IPD or a procedure, we need to see what are the different places where the chances of infection are there, what better we can do. So we have to work into this one, sir, and try to implement.
To Dr. Khalik. So, if we, sorry to interrupt. So, if we I actually remember our olden days, childhood days, we used to live in an independent house, individual house, right? So, we used to have at least some kind of backyard, and usually our restrooms or washrooms are placed away from our house, actually. So, we used to wash our hands, our legs, take a bath there itself, and then enter the home. Now, yes, we are, you know, living in flats or apartments where there is a mix-up at multiple levels, at the parking, at the security, at the lift or at the staircase. And we all, I think more than 99% or 100% of us have actually, you know, attached bathrooms, attached toilets to close to our bedrooms. And we have to cross our main hall where kids may be playing. We have to, you know, cross the bedroom and then enter the toilet to follow all these protocols. So, what is your modification in this current era?
Yeah, one thing, as I said, first thing is, as we come out, as I said, that recently evidence has also come that from the food source also, this virus can be transmitted. That's the reason why I said we have to keep the shoe covers within the car, so that we wear the shoe covers, go to the hospital with those covers, right? And from hospital, once we come, we take out those shoe covers and keep in the small dustbin which we are keeping within the car, right? So that can be excluded. So whatever the shoe is there, that is probably uninfected. Second thing that we are doing is, once we come out, we are leaving all our footwear outside of the home and coming in. Third thing, for an extra precaution, if we want to keep, we can keep our own pair of slippers right at the entrance of the home, the main gate, right? Once we enter our apartment, we wear onto that slippers and directly wash it into the bathroom by going through the hall as well as our bedroom. Third thing is, we need to communicate with our elders as well as particularly with the kids, because they don't understand. Once we come home, there are so many kids who come and work, particularly small kids are there. We need to make them understand that our behavior may be changed for a few months and our closeness of the time may be difficult in the coming few months. That we need to communicate with the kids that we should not be touching once we come to the hospital. And once we these are a few things that can be done after coming back to the home.
Can we use formalin chambers or UV chambers for patient files, violates, mobile?
Yeah, UV has formalin.
Formalin chambers.
Formalin chambers, I'm not aware, but UV has been shown to be having good, denaturating agent against this one. This has been proposed for denaturating the virus, particularly on the masks, etc. If there is a luxury of having a such type of UV chambers, we can use it. Second thing is about the formalin, I am not aware, but one thing that has come about reusing of the N95 masks is one study from Duke University has come, wherein they have aerosolized hydrogen peroxide into small aerosols, and these aerosols were given to the mask for a certain period of time, after which the masks were fit to be reused. By using the formalin, can we make that small size of the aerosols? I am not aware of that one. If that is the condition, we need to look into the literature how effective it is for denaturing the virus.
And further, she adds that patient linen can be ETO sterilized.
Patient's linen, yes, can be ETO sterilized. Patients, and one thing that we proposed previously is, there is a lot of hangama about the PPEs, but one PPE that I think is a must is the N95 mask. Or in a simple word, if I want to say, going to the hospital or a clinic without N95 mask is as equivalent to going out of the home without clothes. Right? So that is the importance of a N95 mask. The rest of, particularly the body, the second important thing is we need to have a proper gloves. That is the second important PP, which is important. The third thing is we should have the footwear. These three are quintessential. The fourth one, which is recommended, is to cover our head, right? The fifth one, which is recommended, is to cover our body. As most of the hospitals will have a large surgical gowns, which are made up of the linen. This can be used because if the virus comes, our body or our skin on the exterior doesn't have these ACE2 receptors. So if at all the patient's fomites or secretions or blood spills on our body due to some accident or during some procedure, the virus is not going to enter our body right from the skin. So the chances of that one are less likely, particularly in the OPD and less aerosol generating procedures. So a simple gown that we commonly used in a surgical procedure with a full hands and a linen based head cover and a good linen based shoe covers can stitch for about 3 or 4 sets of this one, which once we use it on that day, we can wash them in the hot water, dry them and can reuse. In that way, our spending on the PPE can come down significantly. Only PPE on which I personally believe that we should spend are N95 masks and second one are the gloves. These two non-sterile gloves. These are the two things on which we need to spend. The rest all we can use the cloth-based or linen-based PPE, maybe 3 sets or 4 sets or 5 sets, depending upon our practice, and wash them and dry them and we can reuse them.
Dr. Milind is asking, can government make us to work even if we don't want to work? Because some may be having some comorbidity, or maybe having some, some doctor may be elderly age group 60, 65. If they don't want to work, or anybody for that matter, don't want to work.
There is one act which is ASMA in Andhra Pradesh. Chalpati will be in a better position to answer that one. But no one can force anyone to push to the hospital. Obviously, I do feel that particularly elderly people, elderly doctors or doctors, senior doctors or doctors who are having comorbidities like diabetes or hypertension, which is quite common, or people who are having a COPD or such type of high risk group of practicing physicians, it's always advisable not to venture into to go for a practice so affluently. Just to wait and see for under 2 weeks or 4 weeks how the rate of infection is going and what actually the data from India is coming, how much is the mortality rate, right? And then take a guarded way of practicing, because we have seen so many of our colleagues, at least 2 colleagues in Andhra Pradesh have died because of this corona infection. And in India also we are seeing that the doctors are dying. So it's better maybe if we are having a bit of comorbidities, to at least wait for 2 weeks, 4 weeks and see and assess what the data is saying, how infectious our this type of the virus is present, that is present in India, and how good our facilities are able to tackle them, and then venture into practice.
Dr. Mohammed is asking, can N95 be reused?
Yes. N95 has to be reused in a country like India. We don't have a luxury of not using this respirator for a single time. Yeah, for reusing, how many times to reuse? One of our colleague has asked. We don't have a clear cut idea how many times we need to use, but 2 or 3 things are there. In N95, there are small microfibers are there. So the more you use, the more efficient it becomes. It is not like it will become less efficient, because whenever the virus particles comes, there are 3 or 4 mechanisms by which the virus is obstructed. One is the mechanical thing. Second one is a stereotactic charging is there. There is diffraction so that the virus will get engulfed. Not only the virus, but the other particles would get engulfed within these layers of N95. So what happens is once we reuse it repeatedly, the chances of breathe, that there will be much more difficulty in breathing in and breathing out. That is the time when we should be actually changing it. Practically, there are two ways of using it. If we are having less number of N95 masks, there should be at least two, so that the once we are using the first one, the second one we can denaturize it by using a microwave method, which is well described, by steaming this outer surface of the N95 by keeping in a microwave for at least half an hour of time, which can be reused. The second method, which is advised, is by keeping the N95 mask aside without using for at least 4 days, either keeping within the sunlight or keeping aside and not using it. One thing that I suggested is using a Tupperware or a glass-based tiffin box in which we have to take our N95 mask, cover it, write it, okay, this is mask number one. And if it is placed on the sunlight, after 4 days, it can be reused as the fifth one. These are the two practical ways how a smaller clinic or a smaller setup can be used. But in a bigger setup, UV sterilization can be done, or there are places wherein, as I discussed, H2O2 aerosol sterilization is being done. Depending upon the hospital policies, it has to be used. But in a smaller setup, either using 4 N95 masks by using the sunlight or keeping aside, or at least 2 N95 masks wherein a microwave can be used, in which by steam we can denaturize the mask. So the reason before examining the patient, what is the reason why we are examining? Right? The reason for why we are examining is to make a clinical diagnosis of these patients. So if we think that examining this patient is the sore throat or the pharyngitis, either by drinking cold water, allergic thing, or a viral thing, or a bacterial thing, unless proven otherwise, all patients are COVID positive. We have to keep it in mind, right? Second thing is, whenever there is a dire requirement of examining the patient, it's better you wear a proper PPE, including the face shield, and examine that one by using a flexible endoscope, by being away from the patient, either or examine it. But the second thing that can be done is you can stand by the on the backside of the patient, use your mirror, which is used for indirect laryngoscope, right? And ask the patient to open the mouth. By standing behind, keep the indirect laryngoscope mirror close to his mouth and examine the things. These are the two things that come to my mind. Either you use a flexible endoscope by staying away, or stand behind the patient and use an indirect laryngoscope, ask the patient to open the mouth and examine his pharynx.